thank you for coming.
All right, this is normally public comment period, and there are clearly no members in public, so we'll move on to the next item, which is review and approval of last meeting's minutes. Did everyone get a chance to review the minutes, and are there any suggested amendments? Motion to approve the minutes as they stand?
So made.
Second, anyone? My only discussion is, I just wanted to clarify that I communicated some of this to Todd, the 2015-16 timeline planning, and I just want to reiterate, Andrew, do you feel comfortable helping with writing the grant?
Yes.
Okay, all right, then that was my only question. Otherwise, we have a motion and a second, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay, the minutes stand approved. And on to the next item, tree warden's report. We got you on the agenda early this time.
Thank you, I appreciate that. Just wanted to go over just a few items. The first item is the tree order that was placed because of Ralph and Jay's persistence and great help. We ended up with 157 trees.
Within that budget?
$26,917.84.
The trees range slightly smaller just as what was available.
Okay. So they were cheaper.
Actually, they're going to be more expensive. We just happened to get smaller trees, but because of the long winter and the slow, they were late getting in digging plants, so nobody got to dig as much as they wanted.
So the trees were being cost more for what you. Yeah. Okay. The price of trees has gone up.
Was this the famous nursery?
Every nursery.
Well,
who's the vendor?
Bigelow, Amherst Nurseries, Sugarloaf Nurseries, and Northeast Nurseries. We have four vendors.
So those are like pre-acquired for like fall and spring planting season, or they just, they're parked somewhere in a lot?
They are.
We have to go tag.
We have to go tag. We're going to go to Bigelow and do some tagging.
And definitely Amherst.
And Amherst, you tagged one to Sugarloaf?
Yes.
Yeah, Sugarloaf is done, so the only one that is not sure about tagging was Northeast Nursery.
They wanted to pull them out and put them in a separate place.
Okay.
I don't know if they did though, because I stopped contacting them.
Okay.
Once you had the order. So yeah, I think all of those places, and I volunteered to go to some of them with, or if you can't make it.
Have you already gone to Bigelow?
No.
I have to go out there to see Jeff to do work on my own end. So if there's trees that you're interested in, I probably figure out a way to provide the best help. You know, as long as I do my work first, if possible, I can speak with Jeff about it.
I mean, they're all possibly tagged by Bigelow. And there's something that would be voice for it. And if you go, I might go tag along.
Okay.
Or Dave might want to go or quit. So it's all being touched for it. When are you going?
Gotta go between now and like August.
Oh, so yeah.
We're thinking of the day sometime in July.
Can you guys maybe work this out amongst yourselves?
Yep.
Okay, good.
So what's our experience with nursery tagging versus us tagging in terms of quality, shape, species?
You get what you get. So if you don't tag, if you don't go and walk around and actually spend some time to look at the stock that's available and tag it, you end up getting whatever they deliver unless you specify, you know, single stem species. They'll give you anything. You know, they give you species that are in poor form. I've had problems before with other nurseries where I've actually gotten, trees in ball and burlap in a wire basket, but the burlap is gone. So you're just basically getting a tree with a big dirt ball with a wire basket around it, and the root system and the soil's not good, and you're just going to get what you get.
So, yeah, I mean, that was certainly my sense that nurseries are not going to give the cities and towns necessarily the best stock. So I definitely recommend that we establish some sort of policy for tagging our own purchases, and then possibly even setting up standards around what that looks like, other than the species of it.
So I have on the agenda a little bit further down that a discussion about this now 157 street trees that we're going to hope to plant by December 1st. So maybe we could let Rich give us more of his report.
Sure.
And we'll come back to this issue, because I certainly have a lot of, I'm interested in the site choice question.
So just a couple of things. I want to talk about Pulaski Park. The tree removals have all taken place with the exception of the hackberry, which unfortunately after some discussion between Jay and myself and Jay's communication with Alan B, we're not going to be able to move the tree. Jay told me yesterday that Alan B has had experience with removing hackberries in the summertime when they're fully leafed out and they both died.
Yeah.
So I don't really think it's fiscally responsible to spend several thousand dollars to move a tree that are taking a huge risk, so we're going to end up removing it as the project gets a little closer. The project has been, it's been awarded, provided the contracts are all assigned to a mountain landscaping for about a little over $1.5 million for phase one. So construction will probably start in 4 to 6 weeks.
It's really exciting.
Yeah, it's great. Had a few straight emails from folks about the iconic blue spruce, but no, there was really no other pushback from anyone in the community. I've, in communication, though I haven't received anything back yet, from with Alan Snow and Ed Casey, who are both tree warden at Amherst and Springfield. I want to get a copy of their RFP that they used for their tree inventories. Springfield's tree inventory was done probably 7 years ago, so that RFP is a little older, but it's, I think using two, I just want to see what they look like and see how they're constructed. So we, in order to build our own RFP for our tree inventory for this coming year, I need to have some kind of boilerplate to start with. So I'm waiting to hear back from the two of them. Haven't heard back from Attorney Seawald about 191 Spring Street yet. I did send an email today. I don't know if he's on vacation or not. Same with Leah Toyota. 7 Adair Place, where we have a public shade tree hearing on May 20th. The mayor approved the tree being removed after the objections based upon certain conditions that the homeowners have not yet agreed to. So that's in process. And that's really
the conditions seem to be pretty good, okay?
Yeah.
If they go for it in our favor in terms of,
yep,
getting, well, a good number of trees replaced.
The conditions are as follows. They are going to have to, if they agree to it, they're going to have to replace 5 trees in the street. You know, that one tree with 5. And they're also going to have to make an in-kind donation of about $100, plus pay for the tree to be removed.
What kind of tree was it?
Silver maple. So, and that's really all I have to do.
We have rain coming in at 4:20. I might send one of us across the hall just to make sure that he hasn't forgotten. Jay, would you mind doing that? You don't need to rush him, but just want to make sure that he remembers to come. I didn't specifically tell him 4:20, but I gave him the agenda. Yeah.
Okay.
About 10 minutes, do you want to talk about the December 1st energy plan tonight?
Yeah, I'd love to talk a little bit more about that. I mean, I love that we have this extra time and we can also talk about it again later. One of the questions I had was, so bumping from 100 to 157, does that feel viable to get in the ground by December 1st?
It does, and one of the things that Jay and Rob and I kind of communicated about was possibly the tree stock that's coming from Amherst Nursery actually letting that sit in the nursery for let over winter in the nursery and plant those trees in the spring.
Okay.
So that way there we'd be more Amherst Nursery, we ended up 62 trees from Amherst Nursery. So we would plant, you know, a little under 100.
Okay.
100 trees this fall and then plant the other 62 in the spring.
Okay.
Possible that there will be an effort to put together some volunteers that will be trained to help find
those trees we planted in Northampton a long time, and I'd love to get really good PR about it and public enthusiasm. And I think pulling together a volunteer component is a big part of that. So you, Rob, being sort of one of the two people with Jen, thinking about volunteers, I would love for you two to really take that piece on.
I don't know if this is the moment to say it, but I suspect that we'll actually have a report of a program we hope to put in place in so many professionals with so many volunteers, like so many creative and so many weekends. Some kind of plan. And Jen's been offline for a while, or we would have discussed it, brought that to the meeting.
Can I ask a quick question about the size of the trees? So my experience with Amherst Nurseries, those are great trees to plant with volunteers because they're easy to move around for any grow bags.
Yep.
So, I mean, I don't want to comment on what the timeline should or should not be for volunteer involvement, but if you're looking to have volunteers feel like they have a successful experience, those grow bag trees are great for that. You know, anything that requires industrial equipment, volunteers don't really get to do that much.
And I am thinking that even though I heard that they might do them later, I did want to include and help some of those possibly because people can handle them. And also they tend to be successful given the root structure. Whereas we also have 7 gallon pots coming from Sunderland. Those are a little more challenging sometimes in terms of the root structure because they're run around. But
so
we have two different sources.
So what I would love to see is you and Jen pull together a vision of what the volunteer component will look like, so that and then have a timeline associated with it, and maybe bring that back to us, and we can chime in. On.
Yeah. Okay. It would have happened today, except that
I mean, I think that in terms of volunteer engagement, of all the things we've got coming up, that's going to be the biggie for this, for at least this calendar year.
But when it comes to sites, is there already like a prioritization and a pre-selection of where we want trees to be? Is that been addressed at all, or is that kind of involving?
Well, I think that one way that I planted trees in the past is basically planted in places, locations where we've actually had trees removed in the street. A lot of places that we've had trees removed in the past are very mature trees and very little space of tree belt smaller than this table. Those are the kind of places that we'd like to put trees back and try to get homeowners to create a setback plan, that kind of thing. So I definitely think there's plenty of spaces to put the trees. It's just going to require time and effort to go and scout everything out. So I have a list. I keep running a list in the tree folder that I have.
So what kind of like Pleasant Street, has that been identified? Because there's a couple of planting locations along there with this good tree belt. There's beds.
That's also Main Street in Florence. There's been a lot of questions about that as well.
So I'm wondering how we can rationalize this process of identifying sites and making it so that we can all find ways of getting input into the sites. One of the things I realized is the survey is really a great opportunity to ask people if they know of sites, you know, because I think that your way, your approach, which is first addressing those sites where the trees have been removed, I think that's it's a great start. I don't know if it'll get us to 157 trees. It might, but if it doesn't, then I have a question here in the survey which says, are there streets or locations in Northampton where you'd recommend more public shade trees? Please be as detailed as possible. I would love to hear from hundreds of people, giving specific sites. Then some of us can go out and identify whether those are actually really, really viable sites. Another question I was thinking I might find a way to ask is, would your front yard, you know, which is within the public way, but not, no, it's within, help me.
It's in the 20 feet of the right of way.
Yeah.
You're allowed to plant a public shade tree.
Right. So it has public benefit, but is not necessarily on city property.
Right.
I would love to find, have people come forward and say, I'd be willing to have my front yard accept a public tree.
Are you think there's still time to put that in the survey?
I could probably fold it into number 8 in a way, You're limited to 10 questions on serving monkey. So I could probably find a way to fold it into number eight, if people think that that is helpful. We're going to have time to talk about the survey, but I just want to field ideas from the public as much as we can, especially when we're doing this one and only survey. It's kind of our golden opportunity.
Having that detail, I think it would be really helpful, because a lot of people don't know that that is qualified.
Right, yeah. So, okay. So we can circle back to that when we discuss the survey, but that was something I was thinking. And the other thing I was thinking, in our 3 minutes remaining before you're on, Wayne, is maybe creating some kind of a Google spreadsheet where we can all see the sites that you've already got, Rich, and maybe, I mean, this is all, in a perfect world, we'd have an inventory right now, and we'd have it, you know, coordinated with GIS, and we'd have everything laid out on map. But in the absence of that right now, I feel like it'd be great to at least have some document where we can all be dumping in information about potential sites. I'm getting, for example, I'm getting emails or calls probably twice or three times a week from people saying, I'd like a tree, or I'd like a tree in my neighborhood, and I don't really know what to do with that information yet, except for forwarding that to you.
Just forward it to me, and what I do is I put on a master list. So then I take all the master list, it's about 2 years old. So the trees, locations that are planted are on that list, and then I have a list that just runs underneath it. And then people that take priority are people that actually request trees. So for example, that John, 45 Lyman, requested a tree, there was a tree there one time, and we cut it down. Planted two trees twice, it died.
Yeah.
Long story. So I just keep adding all that information to the list, and that's the list I will use to plant, to go and scout out places. And if we're provided a place, then we'll put a stake in the ground, we'll dig safe.
Okay. Do you feel comfortable sharing that list, Rich? And I mean, if we add to it, it's not making it, you know, obligatory for you to plant there, but it's just more, it's a brain dump site.
No, I don't have an issue with it. I may take the list and change it around and have Amy make it available. And you can just dump material in there, or you may choose to make a separate list.
Yeah.
Just a copy.
Yep. And you guys can add things to it, then we can have a finished copy that's crafted in the other list. Because I also have another handwritten list of all the trees we've removed since, I don't know, like a long time. And it's all since the stump list, and that's another list that gets put together. So that's in addition to the running list that I keep adding to it.
So if there's going to be a list, then we would have to note when we put down the space in the future, then whether the property owner or homeowner has requested it or not.
Yeah, right, okay.
So that makes a difference.
So does anyone object to that idea of creating a spreadsheet that we can all have access to? Okay.
So does that mean we take that handwritten list of all the trees that came down? Or that wouldn't be included in it?
No, what I do is at the end of the year, I take, once we grind all the stumps between you have in August, I take all the information from that list and enter it to Microsoft. It's an Excel spreadsheet.
Oh, I see.
Enter all the information that's there, the locations, if there's any obstructions, if there are any utilities, if there are any homeowner comments, and I just fill it all up. And then it's basically first come, first served, but also based on the best location for the trees survivability. A homeowner can ask for a tree in a tree belt half the size of this table, and before we didn't have the ability to ask for setback plantings. Now, you have a form, if you're a homeowner, if you sign this form, you agree to this, put it in your front yard.
Right, that's great.
So.
I'd like to invite Wayne to come and join us at the table.
Hello.
Wayne.
You can see all the names here, Wayne. Thanks for coming. I'm actually going to probably have you, Todd, lead, allow, or sort of frame this discussion with Wayne, because you and Andrew both have a lot more planning experience than I do, and know what sort of questions we want to ask of Wayne. I mean, anyone can chime in, but, you've got the planning background. So.
Okay.
Without putting you too much on the spot, go for it.
Cool.
Wayne. So I think we definitely wanted to have you come and meet with us, hopefully for the first time of several, to stretch that over time, because there's so many issues, I think, in our early conversations here that go beyond staff representation from DPU and definitely venture into the planning realm, whether that be regulations or ordinances that we're already asked to review, or one particular ordinance, economic development, wellness work even, pedestrian connectivity, and the streetscape and planning in general, economic development, it just kind of spills over into a lot of stuff that you and your staff are working on, continue to work on, including grants and climate preparedness, and goes on and on. So I think we wanted to just kind of pick your brain a little bit, get a sense of your thoughts on how we can work together, what's the best way to do that, what your priorities are as they relate to some things that we may be working on in the near to the midterm, and start to kind of clear the mud a little bit as to how we can proceed together and make sure that we're all kind of pushing the same agenda and thoughts as we move forward. I don't really know where we want to start with that, whether it's the regulation side or the other side, but maybe if you just want to kind of open up with a couple of remarks about your general thoughts on how the commission sure. can work with your office. Okay.
Let me talk about sort of what we do in three boxes, if you will, in terms of sort of different regulations and approaches that come in and take this guy to the point. So from a regulatory standpoint, there's two main sets of regs we deal with, the subdivision regulations and the zoning regulations. Subdivision basically applies to the public realm, to brand new streets that are being created, and what's the standard for those streets. And generally required for new projects, 7-foot tree belt and street tree every 30 feet. There's some exceptions in more urban areas, but it's generally the standard. We just changed the rules recently. So it used to be we had a list of trees that would thrive in Massachusetts, and we just changed the list so it's trees that would thrive in Massachusetts, but would also thrive basically in North Carolina. So this is the climate change piece. So we don't want a tree that would have thrived in Northampton, would thrive in Vermont. We want a tree where we're the northern range, because we'll someday be the middle of the range. So that's pretty straightforward. We don't get a lot of subdivisions. So the standards are important for the new projects that come on. State hospital is the most obvious example. And we get, before the recession, we got maybe one subdivision a year. Now we're getting even less than that since the recession. But the subdivision regs have a different, so legally they're about, you know, new streets being created. But the zoning regulations also refer to subdivision regs when we're issuing special permits. So private projects that in some ways look and feel like subdivisions, the same standards apply. So if you're doing a condominium project with a private road, or you're doing single family homes with a private road, or you're doing any one of a number of large projects that might have sort of roadways or driveways, the subdivision standards still apply for those things. So in essence, the same street standards apply for that. The zoning side, sort of similar story, because it refers to subdivision regs. We now are requiring trees that could thrive in more southerly climates as the trees we planted. And we've been changing slowly, or mostly there, that when someone's doing a major new project, so our threshold for things that go before the planning board is also our threshold to kick in some of these standards. And that's basically bigger projects. So a bigger project is, other than a single family home, construction 2,000 square feet or more. So basically everything but single family homes and reuse of existing buildings comes in. Obviously a lot of things are reuse of existing buildings. And sort of where we've been moving the standards is we expect developers to sort of fix the street out to the curb. So we're not asking them to deal with deficiencies within, you know, curb to curb. That's DPW's. We're asking them to fix deficiencies there. But we are asking them to fix whether it's street drainage, street trees, or sidewalks. When a new project comes forward, we want them to bring those things up to standard. And so we're getting more, you know, and that's been sort of a process, but we're getting most projects that applies to. So we're getting more both street trees and sidewalks and other things. Part of the standards that we get, because that 7-foot tree belt isn't really possible in most urban areas, is we're saying we want tree boxes, tree filters in places where the right of way is, where the tree belt is for workers. that's news, and we haven't seen any of those yet. So that's sort of the public right-of-way side of zoning regulations. I guess I don't really exactly know what your charge is, because you're called the Public Shade Tree Committee. We also in zoning have requirements for trees that are off the public right-of-way. There's still trees, they're still important. The ordinance that's before you tonight to comment on sort of fits in that category. It's not about trees in the public right-of-way, so it wouldn't be a shade tree here, but there's still obviously important trees. That area, that ordinance is, I'll stick around when you get to that ordinance, we can talk about that, but that ordinance is important, but it's definitely sort of being, it doesn't go that far, you know, so it's very much a matter of saying, we don't need to cut down a tree and then sneak in a year later for site plan approval, knowing you never would have been able to cut down the tree. It's not a tree preservation ordinance, it's just about premature projects, people who play games, which we know they do. So that's sort of the zoning. The other part of zoning, it's not directly tree related, but it's indirectly, is sort of a vision for how we expect development to occur. This came up most noticeably at King Street, where about 8 years ago, the city rezoned King Street to really require most buildings or most retail to go up to the street, up to the sidewalk. Sort of to make a more urban look, frame the street, to make it more attractive generally. And through a combination of different things going on, the recession, but the zoning being part of it, we really had almost no development during that time period on King Street. So a lot of pressure to come back and revisit it. And so we changed it with a different vision, basically the new vision which passed. So the old vision was just for retail. So that's why automobile services didn't apply. The new vision says you basically get a choice. We still like you to crowd up to the street to create a more urban environment. We know the market doesn't really want that sort of north of the bike path. And so north of the bike path, you have a choice. You can either crowd up to the street or you can ask to create a double tree belt. So I've got to be 6 or 7 feet, but 6 or 7 feet between the curb and the sidewalk, and then another 6 or 7 feet between the sidewalk and the parking lot. So it's sort of saying, you know, we can make it much more attractive for cars. It's still not the same thing as roads up to the street. Downtown, we've definitely not had a focus. Downtown's definitely been about buildings up to the sidewalk as a maximum setback. Other districts are somewhere in between those two. And then the last class which I'm involved with is basically projects that we do. Grant money we bring in. So sort of de facto split between what my office does for transportation, what DPW does, is any project which is using Chapter 90 money or which is using city funds is really DPW. They do a good job of bringing me into the loop, and my office is a loop, so a part of the conversation, but they're the lead. Projects which we bring in grant money for, and those vary from a bunch of grants we got at the state hospital to applying for a project on plus this year, talk about in a second, to, you know, a lot of the grants we get, we tend to take the lead. Again, DPW is very involved in improving all those projects. Our projects tend to, where DPW is fixing 2 miles of street a year, whatever it is, our projects tend to be very narrow and around a specific thing. So Pleasant Street right now, we're applying for a grant, no idea if we get the grant, but it's to transform about half a mile of Pleasant Street. Right now, Rich isn't going to hear this. But right now, the city layout into Holyoke Street, we're in the process of taking over the MassDOT layout up to Hockman Road, which means for Chase to maintain it, and eventually we'll be taking it over all the way to the interstate. Mm-hmm. And the reason we want to take this over is MassDOT is in the highway business, they do a good job of the highways. We're much more in the street business, so they don't allow on-street parking, for example. Their stuff is really mostly about, you know, highways. And so we want to, this part of taking over Pleasant Street slowly, this goes with putting the roundabout in on Pleasant Street and Cons. We want to add parking lanes, but part of this project is also street trees as well. And Pleasant Street brings up the classic thing which DPW deals all the time. It's a very constrained right-of-way. So, you know, I'm a great believer in street trees, but I'm also a great believer in bike lanes and 6-foot-wide sidewalks and cycle tracks. And, you know, Pleasant Street, except for one area, we're doing this whole project that I need to take. So, new land taking. So, Pleasant Street layout today will be what the Pleasant Street layout is going forward. And so that creates challenges for what we want to do. So, I mean, if you want to get involved in details, I can give you, but like, you know, right by, we used to be mailboxes, the UPS store, Millbank 2, there's an area there with a steep slope up to the sidewalk. I we're planning putting trees there, even though it's private property, because we don't think there's room in the tree belt, because we want some tree belt for a cycle track.
And so you do that through taking?
Well, that one, we hope that they're willing to do it. That one, we potentially could pay for a tree. I guess that 25th thing I haven't heard about, I'm curious about that. But we could potentially spend money from the grant and give them a tree. I was thinking we need an easement to be legal, but if we could just do that, that's great.
As long as they agree to it.
Okay.
So you're saying that's one of the rare locations where you actually can put in trees? Is that what you're saying?
No, we can put trees elsewhere. It's one of the rare locations where we're not competing with other good purposes.
Okay, I see.
So there's a lot of places, Pleasant Street, the sidewalk is a little bit 4 feet and this tiny little, and so there'd be trade-offs for all those things. When one of them they're trying to do on Pleasant Street, which might have appeal elsewhere, there's a lot more low impact drainage. Some places where we let the water off the street instead of going to a catch basin, and it might be sort of a place for street drainage goes into, you know, basically a tree well, and we support some sort of landscape in there.
That's where they can bump out some like minor LNG features could really be integrated without working across purposes of the sidewalks.
Yeah, yeah. But we're planning, well, on Pleasant Street, we're looking at just 4 bump outs, so it's not a lot, but at Holyoke Street and at Short Street. And the current, looking at it is, can we do both a curb extension and then a little park, basically a little tiny triangular park. So there's an angle that DPW wants for plowing. Can we put a tree in there? But one of the things we're dealing with is visibility. Can we really do a tree in a way that's visible? Like for our subdivision rules, right, so we need trees every 30 feet. The one exception is right by intersections where we want to have good sidewalks. So that, you know, sort of looking at all that, we have a small program as part of our open space plan, which we call pavement to parks. We're basically looking at other places which we could take pavement and reclaim it. So if you look at, again, as far as Pleasant Street, you look where Hockerman Road comes in, and it's really wide. It's literally like 45 feet or wider, curb to curb. And we think we can knock out 15 feet of that, you know, and create a tiny little park for drainage with a couple of trees there. We're looking at, you could take a lawn chair in front of City Hall and be 10 feet out from the curb and not be hit by anybody all day long. So we're looking at, we extend the curb over here. We're looking at Cracker Barrel Alley across the street from City Hall, where they shouldn't actually be a driveway there. We go to the parking lot there. We do a title search just to make sure it's ours. But we're looking for that to become a little sort of outdoor seating with or without trees. That may not, maybe too much of our estate for trees. So that kind of project comes into this way.
Yeah, and what you're describing is a lot of like little clusters. And especially having just returned from Europe, where you see trees so neatly spaced along an avenue, creates a beautiful, you know, LA. I'm wondering if your office could also look at pavement to some, you know, something green in a really systematic way in areas of downtown. I mean, we're hoping to complete our inventory of downtown. We went up here last night except for thunderstorms. But it's just abundantly clear that there are whole, you know, tracks of King Street especially, even in the right of the intersection, main intersection town, where just there are no trees. And so is that a possibility to explore actually looking every 30 feet, we're going to remove pavement or sidewalk or whatever, in compliance with all the regs, and put in trees?
Yeah, so that's what the pavement for parks initiative was, is to look at those things. The challenge, again, is this trade-off. So we're hoping to kick off a process where we redesign, you know, Main Street was last, all the sidewalks were done in 83, somewhere thereabouts, and they're showing their age. And so we're looking at sort of all of Main Street, redesigning Main Street from basically West Street all the way down to Market Street. And so that'd be part of it, but so the trade-off there is, and one of the opportunities there is to drop for the travel lane. We make it narrower. But just, you know, in terms of the competing things, we're looking at, could we do dedicated, we can't do all these things, but these are sort of trails. Could we do dedicated bus lanes to downtown? Could we do cycle tracks to downtown? Could we widen this the sidewalks? Could we put low impact development drainage? Can we do wider tree belts? So those are certainly part of that discussion, but I don't want to look at those separate from all those other good
things. Absolutely, yeah, that makes sense. I don't know how though, so how do we engage with that planning process you're doing? Because for me, you know, the benefits of having a line shaded downtown, you know, in terms of economic activity and pedestrian comfort and traffic calming, it's like, it feels so compelling. And so I want to make sure that, you know, those arguments are at the table when you're thinking about all those competing interests.
Yeah, it's going to be a very public process because all those things are public.
Okay. And when, how would that pick?
So three different scales, if you will. Well, four scales, one which we did. So we hired Nelson Lagarde as a transportation firm about 3 years ago. We did a public charrette, got people involved, and that's sort of what convinced us that there may be some external road real estate that we could draw. They didn't go incredibly into the weeds, but just sort of like we probably have some real estate that we could spare. So that was sort of the first part. The second part is about to start now. And I don't know how public the process it is in terms of public input. PVPC is basically just collecting data for us, traffic counts, traffic crash data. And if they get into recommendations, that would sort of be a public process. If it's about raw data to help inform us, that may be, you know, more technical things. The third process, Todd mentioned the connection to health. So we have what's called a Mass in Motion grant, which sort of ties health and planning together. And one of the projects we're looking at doing for this year is basically doing a transect for streets. So, you know, I said that we have a plan now that the developers redo the property. We expect them to own the street after the curb. But if that happens, you know, Shaw's Motel gets developed tomorrow, and someone comes into us and says, what's the standard here? We don't really have a clear standard. With the subdivision standard, what would we do if we had lots of real estate? But we don't have anything written that says, okay, we don't have that real estate. You know, so if we have right now, I'm making this up, for the sake of argument, there's a 4-foot tree belt and a 5-foot wide sidewalk, and maybe an extra couple of feet before a property owner. So if we have 10 feet or 12 feet, you know, what's the right thing to do there? So that's the next process we're going to kick off. That's going to be a very public process, again, because that is where we're starting to balance those different goods, you know, wider sidewalks, tree belts.
Is that going to be by district, by or very specific to Pleasant and Main, or is that going to be more citywide?
Depends on funding. So we've applied for a grant, which so far we have to hear. The more money we have, the more in the weeds we get. The less money we have, the more hypothetical. You know, yeah. So we're starting really with that graphics and just having a spreadsheet. You know, if we have a strip of land that's 1 foot wide, we can do a walk trail. If we have a strip of land that's 8 feet wide, we can do a bike path. If we have a strip of land that's 60 feet wide, we can do this with different traffic counts. And one of the variables would be where it is in town. But how fine grain you get, I'm not sure the answer.
Right. So when you said transit, you weren't referring to like a new urbanism type of, you know, where they kind of lay out, you know, the city center and then going up from there, the different standards that go with those.
So some of that, but the constraint being the right of way, the equally big constraint.
Okay.
But it might still be transit sort of thinking about right of way, you know, 1 foot to 100 foot right.
Wait, thanks for sharing this information with us. I just wanted to echo what Lily said in terms of I'm hoping through the public process that there's a way to find complementary needs here, because recently I was in St. Louis and I was so impressed with these huge street trees. I mean, it's just so lovely. You do sort of feel like the sidewalks are maybe not as wide as you might like, but at the same time, I feel like all those trees added this element that actually drew people to the streets. I often find that sometimes a narrower passage actually can be inviting of sort of this public space. If people have to navigate the space, it sort of forces you to meet somebody, you know what I mean? Instead of having a wide lane that's treeless, having the combination of walkways, bikeways, tree-lined streets. So it was just an example of a city where there's really obviously been some planning and beauty and functionality. Yeah.
So I hear that there are short, near, and long-term opportunities for this commission to interact with the long-term goals of the city. I mean, it sounds like short term there could be opportunities within that segment of the area that sometimes may not be counted upon to potentially wrap ourselves into that process. I'm thinking of some locations north of the bike path where you have like monoculture and you just plant like one variety of tree and that's it. You know, it'd be nice if this group could say plant 4 or 5 different varieties of trees so you don't have everything go out in the past.
Yeah.
I mean, near term it does sound like the Pleasant Street right away definitely long term, it's the overall vision, especially for the city, for downtown, Main Street, the main gateway, you know, intersections into and out of downtown. So it's like there's a real opportunity to try to make, you know, strategic about how we can take some exciting things, such as, you know, stormwater, you know, maintaining the stormwater money is now in the area where the emerging data seems to indicate there's a way to treat stormwater, or be close to the source, while we can see things that people care about.
Andrew, do you mind speaking just a little louder?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, while enhancing some things people care about, you know, which is, you know, the quality of life in the area that they're experiencing. So I really think that this is kind of a good time to have those discussions when it comes to what we can do to participate in those areas.
Right, I think you're absolutely right. Part of the debate, I mean, some things I'm sure will get referred to you guys as a committee, and some things you guys just need to get involved in the process so that, you know, I think in your last email you talked about our the focus group sessions we're doing in September, and so I hope you guys do that for my invitation. We just did a walk and tour of Pleasant Street to sort of help inform that process. And, you know, as you guys get up to speed, that's the kind of thing in the future.
Yeah. We had actually intended to have someone in that, but it just didn't turn out that way. But we're really, those kinds of things are on our radar. But to the extent that you can, when you know something could be tree-related, that you can pop me a direct email, that would be so helpful. Thank you.
And you guys also might, just to forget, you know, we have our listserv, so every meeting we do, we list our planners' listserv, and you're on it.
I'm definitely on it.
I was wondering how much you consider structural soil. I know trees downtown, it's a big limiting factor. There's no place for them to grow. And when you're redoing, especially big sections of sidewalks, is that in your discussion?
It's in our discussion. So that's one of the things in the subdivision regs now. That's the thing about if you're going to have less than 7 foot, maybe 6 foot caliber tree belt, you know, it's easier for the private sector because we're making them pay for it, but we're expecting them to put tree boxes in and, you know, and have the kind of right kind of soil. That's part of the discussion. We hired Niche Engineering as the firm we're using for Pleasant Street, and that's one of the things that they're looking at. Those tree cutouts are tiny.
Yeah.
One is DPW asked, which we're talking about yet, is, you know, what's the right way to protect the trees, or graves that girdle the trees, or, you know, and that's one of the things I'm looking at. To the extent we're ripping up some of the sidewalks, can they do the right soil under the sidewalks, and then put the sidewalk on top so the tree roots can go out for doing that. One is we talked about, like right by what used to be City Hall, you know, what they're calling now, on corner Pearl and Pleasant Street. You can see
the tattoo place.
Oh, is that what it is? Okay.
Yeah.
Where the roots of a tree are throwing the sidewalk on. And so we've talked about, like in DC, they've used these rubberized materials to go over those things. You know, that's one to be asked is that a solution here? I don't know about the material. So, yeah, it's absolutely one of those. There's various. In suburban areas where there's land, there's not an issue. In urban areas.
Yeah.
But really expensive. So, much easier when we have a state grant or when we have a private sector.
I don't know if anybody's talked with contractors getting someone locally licensed to make the structural soil. So I think the biggest cost for us here in Western Mass is trucking it. I think it's the nearest place is Boston area. So if you get a local contractor to get licensed to make the soil.
Yeah, that's something that might have already been gone over. I just did that on King Street. I just took a walk down there this week. There are a lot of trees that are planted in crop, you know. Very impressive. Just like it's in front of the supermarket, there's a tree that's still in its bag. It's been in the ground for years, but still, it didn't get a graphic. It's synthetic burlap. Never have it. You have some regulations that cause people to put trees in the double tree belt. Is there anything to be done about causing the trees to be well treated or properly planted or anything like that? I mean, it's very disheartening. As I walk down the street, I think pretty much, except for, there are a couple places where they planted them properly. Most of them, there is no root flare. It's very,
volcanoes
around them. They're still in their burlap. All those things, there's somebody cutting tops or something.
These are part of the
So we do for a subdivision, when new things are planted and they have to pay for like 1 year after the project goes public. But I'm not disagreeing with you in terms of the inspections can certainly be a lot better. The good news for site plan approved projects, you know, the is they sort of own the responsibility for the tree. So if the tree dies, then we should be able to go after them to get them to replace the tree. When National Grid comes and chops off the top of the tree, because the lines, that's different. We don't really have a lot of recourse. In fact, National Grid says, hey, we're going to do this, have them plant crab apple trees. Or,
but that wasn't the case of the tree.
So in other words, the tree dies. I guess the answer might be that somebody from the DPW or from this commission go to the people who are then responsible for replacing the tree and say, please try to plant it properly. Because I think there's very little incentive to plant it properly. And that they're not necessarily looking for a great big tree, which is what happens if you take care of it. They thrive. There's no interest in it.
Right, right. And the other thing, again, I'm not trying to volunteer all your time, but so my office permits the projects, it's in the building department who does the inspections for the projects. I suspect that there's a formalized process for getting input. I mean, Jay's helped in the past for specific projects, but Carol will call him up with a question for the project. That there's probably some, you know, if you guys wanted to inspect them, I suspect the building inspector would be happy to have those parties.
So he's the one who signed up for the landscaping?
Right, so Carol Mission, my office, is staff's planning board, will get involved to varying degree. I mean, ultimately, it's his decision.
So he'll say landscaping, plans that we
you often call Carol and consult her. It's a little different for subdivisions where it's a more formal process and we hold that the credit.
Yeah, and Louis came in and visited with us 2 weeks ago. Well, sorry, 2 meetings ago. And, you know, some of his comments were, you know, he's not an arborist. So he's really not in a position to say whether a tree has been planted properly or not. And then he also likes things really simple, like dead tree, a live tree. If it's a dead tree, you know, then he knows what his job is. If it's a quasi-alive tree, you know, foundering tree, it's really gets complicated. And then he was very honest about just capacity issues. So I just wanted to, because we're running out of time with you, and I want to invite you back, first of all, because I don't feel like we're done with this conversation. And I think it's an ongoing conversation since you're just across the hall. We'd love to invite you back.
And you're decent meeting hour. I like your meeting.
Yeah, right. But what I wanted to ask is just your candid opinion of what's not working. And, you know, Rob sort of illuminated a piece of it. And I'd just like to hear if there are other aspects of both the regulation and the enforcement that you really feel like could be tightened up and that we should turn our attention to.
Maintenance generally. I mean, it's so much easier to get someone to plant a tree than to get it maintained. The planting is part of it. But also, you know, we know trees, and again, I'm not a tree person, but they have to be watered for a certain amount of time before they take care of themselves. Yeah.
Is that in any of the specifications?
Again, they own the tree if it dies, so it's their responsibility. The reason we have a letter of credit for subdivision trees is those trees get turned over to the city. And when they die, it becomes our headache, and that's why we want a guarantee from the developer. For a site plan approval, they own the tree basically forever.
Even if it's on public property?
Yeah, because their project's being approved for doing it. What you see some people do is they play a game, frankly, and I don't know about Leo, so I'm not speaking for them, but I've seen that kind of thing where somebody says, I'm going to cut the tree, oh, whoops, you're going to make me replant it, that's fine, but you're starting all over again. You're starting back to a 200 caliber.
Which is just fine for them.
Right, exactly.
So I think that's where we really add value in the overall process, and obviously some steps have to take place, but you know, we're going to have like a member of the commission, a representative of the commission, come through and say, building inspector, you know, this tree is or is not planted correctly and will die, you know, in the next, you know, 2.5 years. And right. I think that'll be an easy, well, everything's easy, but that'll be an easy fix. That would add value.
So technically that would probably be enforceable because the site plan is going to have a detail as to how to plant a tree.
Right, although site plan most, I mean, so that's the other approach to get involved. The regs in subdivisions have some details, the site plan not so much. We're in essence approving the proposal. So a landscape architect designs the tree and the planning board approves it. We don't necessarily give a standard. And so if that's useful, it's not something I could write, this isn't my expertise. But if there was a standard that says, you know, pull the burl out, you know, whatever those things are.
But on the landscape plan or the site plan, there's not a detail of a tree planting, a section.
There's always the ANSI standard where they just follow what ANSI says to do, but then the guy from Kennedy who retired probably doesn't know.
No, but that's what I mean. But it's on the plan, it's approved by the planning, therefore that's the standard, and if that's not followed,
it's detail. Yeah. So some of those plans are better than others. And I mean, Andrew's right, there's no question, sometimes you get a good landscape architecture plan and then a lousy installer. But the reverse is also true. We get good, reputable installers who say, this isn't gonna work. You know, the Y is a good example. Berkshire Design does good work for us. Berkshire Design shrubbery that would be underneath those Norway maples that should come down anyway.
Where is this one?
The YMCA.
Oh, YMCA.
And the installer came in and said, that, you know, this is not gonna work. This, you know, soil type, this shading is too much.
Yeah.
And so it goes both ways in terms of who screws up.
All right, well, we've run out of time on that, although it looks like the next thing on our agenda you might want to stick around for, right? Because...
Zombies.
Yeah, we were talking about this draft tree protection ordinance.
Right, one comment I make, but you have comments due to council by August 20th. Just so you know the process.
Yes.
So it tends to be council's not the one who takes all these comments. Each committee wants to hear from the previous committee. So ordinance committee and planning board won't hold a public hearing until you make comments. So even though we hope this goes back to council, we hope you will make a recommendation as soon as possible so we can go on to the next committee.
Okay. So I just actually counted 90 days out from the time.
Okay.
So I you know, that's my rough estimate, actually. But what you're saying is that we need to get our comments to a subcommittee or a committee of the council before it goes to council. And ideally, you'd like that before August 1st.
Right. We didn't have the dates, but Carolyn hasn't scheduled. It'll be a public hearing for ordinance committee and planning board. And she hasn't scheduled that, so we're hoping to get comments.
So I mean, I don't want to speak for everybody, but I will just speak for myself here, in that, you know, we're brand new and we're zoomed way out, and that's exactly where we feel like we should be at this point. So to have this draft ordinance on our lap with the expectation that we comment on it, it feels rushed to us. So I wanted to ask whether or not it's appropriate to ask for more time. We want to do things right, and we've already got a couple of people on the committee assigned to looking carefully at the ordinance and comparing it to what other municipalities have both written and had success with, you know, because something written doesn't necessarily mean it's executed well or there's enforcement. Is that an appropriate thing to ask for?
So this really came from two councillors, Councillor Adams
and O'Donnell,
thank you. So it's really a question more for them. I think they're, I don't know how anxious they are for the time or not. I mean, I will point out, we're a city, so it's easy to go back. So it's not the same as a town. We want to get everything right for town meeting. City Council tends to approve things incrementally. So let's say, for example, you thought it should be much stronger. That's less likely to pass the first time. It's more likely to have some pass and strength more later. But beyond that, time is relative to that.
Okay, all right. So we should talk directly to them?
And was this something, when you said came from, did they write it, or?
So they approached us and asked for help. They brought the concept.
An issue that they had flagged and they asked.
And actually independently. I don't know, there were a bunch of trees cut in a condominium on Bridge Street, and it was around that time. I don't know if that's what, and in fact, those trees wouldn't have been stopped by this ordinance anyway. But they independently contacted us and we said, let's all meet together.
That's probably similar to other concerns that folks have. It's like, I want to see a few funding options. So, but also at the same time, I don't think the ordinance itself is doing any harm. So kind of operating under the don't perfectly anything we did.
Yeah.
I would like to have the opportunity to come back and have a more comprehensive public safety ordinance that address, you know, what you do when there's an illegal cutting, how you deal with levying fines, what's the process for dedicating funding, you know, from that. And I would like to have that open as a later avenue. The ordinance itself, and don't think it's going to do any harm, but you know, I would like to know that we will be coming back with more comments.
All right, well, then I'd just like to turn to Marilyn and Todd, since you guys volunteered to do a little bit of work on this, to ask whether you feel like you can do the research you feel you need to do. And again, it doesn't sound like it needs to be comprehensive and we have to get it perfect, especially if Andrew, you knowing, you know, regulatory issues, looked at it and you feel like it passes the smell test, then do you two feel like you could work on, again, running it through just a first pass? And Jay, I know you had some comments about language Do we feel like we can pull something together by August 20th?
For this, I do. I mean, I think for the most part, this ordinance is dealing with the realm of trees that is furthest from our core, which is trees on private property that aren't necessarily going to be anywhere near a street, perhaps, you know, so that they, so our concentration on it, I think, should be more advisory as opposed to, you know, if those two councilors proposed a public shade tree protection ordinance, that would be something that we'd want to, you know, really do a deep dive in. So I think given the nature of the ordinance, that it only deals with, is it private trees on private property, that, you know, so we're not going to be, you know, setting ourselves up for failure by doing a recommendation on that.
Okay, would it be better to have a comprehensive ordinance that dealt with all the issues, or to have separate ones?
Well, I'm not sure the answer. I mean, let me tell you my biggest concern in terms of where you went with that, with an ordinance, is one of the things we tried to do is sort of streamline the process of what goes before what committees. And so it seems like public shade tree stuff should certainly be coming before you guys. Trees on private property should be part of the normal planning process, not at other committees. The process part's more important to me. How strict the regulations is really up to council. I'm happy to be stricter. I'm not sure what their appetite is for those things. But I think that in terms of, I think it's two separate documents, one for public shade trees as defined by state law and one for private pieces. So I wouldn't make it comprehensive in terms of in the same ordinance.
Well, I think our thought, I think what you might be getting at though, Marilyn, is that for subdivisions and the trees that are planted as part of subdivisions become public shade trees, in essence. And the same, you know, could be true with certain projects on King or whatever, yeah, what have you. So I think getting the, you know, having us get our heads around the list that was updated and the standards by which those are planned and, you know, 30 feet or what have you, but other things that go into that, I think that's what Marilyn might be referring to in terms of just getting our heads around the comprehensive nature of this standard. Not so much the process for review, although I think that's also critical. Well, you know, right now we're getting our heads around the process and also the standards themselves.
But it may be that you want a comprehensive vision of where you want to go, but then once you have a vision, the documents make a difference. So subdivision standards, for example, are by the planning board, not city council. Zoning is adopted by city council. So you want, obviously, they should be talking to each other, they should be consistent, but the actual group is dominant.
Okay, so for the sake of moving this forward, I'd like to propose, let's see, our meeting schedule, I don't have a calendar with me, don't have it fully together yet, haven't landed 2 feet on the ground yet back in the United States. But we have a meeting next week. That's probably not giving you enough time, but what about the fall, like in 3 weeks? Do we have a meeting in 3 weeks? I know there was one date, I guess it was just the first one, we didn't have a quorum, but we don't have one until the 5th?
No, we have one next week.
One next week, and then 2 weeks after that? So that's what?
The 22nd.
Do we have a meeting on the
15th?
No, if we're skipping a week of the 27th, then I have it on.
Okay, so how does that feel? Does that feel doable? Yes, okay. All right, then I think we're gonna shoot to try to have some comments to whoever next, sometime after the 5th, before the 20th. Okay, does that sound like a reasonable goal? Okay.
Yeah. Just an overall question. So regarding like a more comprehensive public shade tree ordinance, should be working with a counselor to try to get that process initiated, or who should we contact when we are ready to initiate that? Do we just reach out to some counselor?
I don't think that. Unless counselor, you know, I haven't actually mastered the new charter. Under the old charter, any standing committee could introduce the ordinance to council, so you didn't need a council sponsor. So unless they change that, I don't think they have.
You do or you don't?
You do. You didn't under the old one. I'm not sure about that.
Okay, all right.
So I think it could just be sponsored by you guys, you know. I mean, that said, the process is cumbersome to amend things on the council floor, so the more informal working you can do with other committees and other departments and counselors, the better off it is. I don't think they need to formally sponsor.
Okay, and then I guess one last question before you do, although you're welcome to stay as long as you want, is, you know, we're trying to use these early meetings to meet all the relevant city officials who intersect with public shade trees. We've met with Louis and Passbrook. Anyone else so far? I guess it's just been you. We haven't had that many meetings, although we did invite the chair of the Amherst Shade Tree Committee to our last meeting. We have a number of people on our...
We're going to reach out to Terry.
Yeah, we have a number of people on our list, and I just thought I'd run them by you and see if you have anyone else who feel like we should. So, Chris Mason, if you feel like that's, if he could contribute anything.
So this is a debate which I could represent, although Chris might represent more passionately, is when do we not require big shade trees when they're going to block solar?
Yeah.
So we have the state hospital transformations, that's for larger trees. And the subdivision rigs actually have a standard. You know, if you prove to us that you can block your solar panels, you can do smaller ornamental trees. And that's actually new in the subdivision. But Chris is much more passionate about that, so he might be the person to bring it.
Yeah, I do think that's an issue that's going to come up in the future, but we should probably start having a conversation about the conflict between trees and solar panels. All right, so Chris Mason, Terry Masterson, economic developer, the stormwater guy, Doug McDonald, the forester for DPW.
I can see his face.
Yeah. Is there anyone else?
Michael Morey.
Okay.
The utility.
No. Utility?
We will cut the trees above the wires.
Oh no, although I think that's a good person to have.
Lance Wade. To have a relationship with Lance Wade would be valuable.
Yeah. Are there other people you feel like we should have early conversations with just to develop a personal relationship?
Nobody stands out. Let me think about that. I think that's all. I'll email you. It's only comes down.
Okay. And if Todd and Marilyn have any specific questions about the ordinance,
yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Thank you for coming.
Thanks.
Thank you. I need something. The meeting that they're going to present you with a proposal.
That would be okay. Well, on the 5th, you two will come back with any research findings, recommendations regarding the draft ordinance for private tree protection.
Schedule meeting available somewhere? That was my mom.
Well, it's always going to be the first and third Wednesdays, except for this month we didn't have a quorum on the first Wednesday, so we bumped it to the second and third.
It's another game of party.
Oh.
You have to have the door?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, thanks. Okay, so here we are. We're talking about, this is all under the heading of timeline planning. Because we have, feels like we've got some stacked tasks for us, especially in the fall, I just want us to make sure that we are attending to these, we have a timeline, and we have assigned leaders for each of these subjects. And one of the big ones, really big ones, is actually this public charrette that we have envisioned, and we've roughly conceived of it happening sometime in September.
Can I ask a question about that?
Yeah.
Do we have to plan ourselves if we hire someone to do it? Like, if there's funds in the budget that, you know, because everybody has done this, it's always more work than you think it's going to be. I mean, if we can work to get maybe, you know, $5,000 set aside to hire somebody for a few days to plan it, that might just be so much less painful for everybody, you know, overall. I mean, obviously that comes with the can of worms and money's on it, but it's a lot to take on to do it well by yourself.
Well, I do hate to say it, because it's my favorite organization in the world, but we could have staff reach out to PVPC, because each community within PVPC gets a bunch of free hours. I don't know if you'd use them for anything like that. They're not going to blow your thoughts off, but they could provide certain structural assistance for the process. I don't know how much, you know,
Can we just break it down? What does this look like, and what are the components that would take human hours?
you want to have a good outreach plan. You want to have a good agenda. You want to have good materials, good meeting boxes, note takers, minute takers, somebody who's a trained facilitator. So if somebody starts yelling at somebody, they can diffuse it, you know, successfully. And I think usually it's just all the effort that it takes to get people to show up in a room and to make it productive. You know, I've done it both ways, where I've worked with consultants and I've done it myself, and it wears you out to do it yourself, you know. And it's, I mean, it's kind of cool to think of doing it, like, as a group, but at the same time, if the option is there to, like, find somebody locally who's good and can do it and not rip the city off, you know, it's always nice to have somebody who's like, this is what we're thinking, is this feasible, can we make this happen with what you've given us, how can you deliver, you know, a product.
It would be worth the money. It would add a professional level to this.
I just want to zoom out a second and ask ourselves whether we're timing as well. You know, it feels like the online survey we could do right away. You know, we've got the questions. It's a free thing. We've got a list from Wayne's office. We've got neighborhood listservs we could send it out to. We could get hard copies out in really choice locations around the city. And however, when you're talking about a charrette that has, like, you know, maps and materials and it requires some public education, I'm just wondering if this shouldn't happen after the inventory is done, when we actually have some information we can bring to them and say, okay, here's what we've got. Where do we want to go from here? It does mean postponing us creating a vision, but in some ways, we're not in a position to create a vision until we know what we have.
Well, I think when it comes to the inventory, it may be possible to pull those two tests together. When it comes to the overall, like, here's our inventory, here's the status of what we have, where do we want to be in the future? I think it's possible to accomplish those goals.
We could even tie that into a grant application.
Oh, yeah. Probably. Yeah, because you want to have a good public process with any plan you're producing. So, I mean, there's no need to.
This feels rushed to me. I mean, September is so right around the corner. I would really like to propose that we do something like that, where we tie it into the broader tree inventory, so that when we actually do go to the public, they have a sense of, okay, here's where we are, now where do we want to go?
And what are you thinking would make better sense in terms of time? Later on in the fall, or actually next year?
No, next year. Because the inventory is going to take all fall.
Inventory and or even tree planting is going to take a lot of time. We get volunteers involved in training them.
Yeah.
Which will also inform us, though, is, you know, how we function, what we can offer.
What if we do something smaller scale, just because we have a new committee with all this energy and we're still trying to get ourselves, you know, known to the community? I'm just wondering if we had some sort of public meeting where after the survey goes out, we just sort of hold the space for questions, comments, and let people know we're going to do the inventory with the planting, and then in the spring we're going to do like a larger charrette. Because it's just, if we wait that long, then we're almost coming up on a whole year for when we formed.
Well, one of the things we could do is sort of galvanize our base, and by having a lot of volunteer engagement in the planting, that, you know, that becomes our base. And we could sort of see that as like a focus group, and maybe present our focus base with some of those questions that we want to kind of test out on them, and then, you know, launch to a larger public.
That's a good point. We're one of the few committees that can get people going. I mean, you know,
we've already got
a sign committee or whatever is going to get people that going. So I think that's a really good point. And, you know, this relates to a question I had around, you know, can we have our own social media presence, whether it's Facebook or what have you? Can we control that type of thing to keep it more engaged than, you know, a city website or what have you?
That's a good question to ask the mayor. Because from what everything I heard from you, Rich, the mayor likes to control communications. And so we can certainly ask, but I suspect that it's going to have to be a separate citizen group that will do something. That's my guess. But that's not such a bad thing.
No, it's not a bad thing, but I do think it gets to, you know, how kind of Marilyn is speaking to, and how do we announce ourselves in terms of, you know, letting that galvanized citizenry know that they have a voice now, and that they have something, some sort of thing to link into. And I think that the flip side of that is we have to continue these conversations with Wayne, et cetera, and get very explicit with link us in, and what are the official ways in this city that different entities get linked in together. I think, you know, we might uncover that that may or may not happen as well as we wanted to.
Yeah.
Is the tree planting going to happen on a certain day or number of days, Rich? Or is it going to
be a number of days? Probably weekends.
So I was just thinking we could maybe organize something around one or a number of the tree plantings.
Well, I thought your idea of having a sort of charrette, just announcing that we've got the survey, we're looking at different issues, and invite the public to come and discuss it, sort of limited. Or
I think we could do it in the context of one of our meetings, maybe.
Yeah.
We could maybe dedicate one of our meetings. But again, I don't want to invite people to do something we're not prepared to,
But we could have it be very limited, tell people, just, we just want to discuss this. You know, do you want to make a comment about this survey, or do you want to make a comment about the, if we don't have the inventory, I guess we can't do that.
We certainly, first of all, I feel like this survey needs to go to the mayor's office first to be approved, because it is, you know, official. And then once we're ready to launch it, I think that, again, I guess via the mayor's office, we have a press release. And the press release could include some of these things that are happening in the fall, like that we're applying for a grant to conduct a thorough inventory, that we're planning to plant 157 trees and looking for volunteers to help with the planting. You know, so I think that there is an opportunity just in what we've already got planned for a lot of public awareness building. I mean, for the sake of our sustainability and capacity, I would strongly recommend that the whole concept of charrette just be pushed forward. I just feel like we're just not quite ready for it yet. And that what we can also do in something like a press release is invite the public to come to either any of our meetings or a specific one where we have an extra long public comment period. Maybe we want to just say we're dedicating half our meeting to a public comment period or something like that. Maybe have some kind of structure to it, but not.
Well, before we postpone it, I would just maybe want to review, okay, what were the main things that we wanted to get out of the charrette, and how can we ensure that we're working on those pieces before next spring or whenever we have it. So I would say, okay, we can put it off, but the things that we would want to accomplish through it, how can we at least be chipping away at it? Mm-hmm. How do we get the support? How do we help in the leadership? How do we make sure the public is aware? Like, what little pieces can we take off in the meantime?
So do you feel like some of these things that we have in the fall can help in that way?
Yeah, the press release, I mean, how effective do you feel press releases are?
Depends if they're picked up.
Yeah, you know, I know that now the mayor doesn't, you know, I used to be very sort of obsessive when I was with Grow Food of following up every press week with a phone call to the media. The mayor's office doesn't have time to do that. Consequently, the last press release that we sent out, or that he sent out related to us, wasn't picked up by anybody. So I will just do that.
Uh-huh.
I'll call them and say, I want you to know that the mayor's office has released a press release about the tree commission, and that we're excited for you to cover it.
Do you know the reporters' numbers already?
Yeah, I know a lot of them.
All right.
Yeah, I mean, if you have any others.
No, that's good.
Also, if we say that we're about to plant a bunch of trees with volunteers, the Gazette will send someone out.
Yeah. Especially if we say
that committee formations are news.
Right, exactly.
Right.
But we can tag on
people with dirt on their hands.
We might be able to tag on to that, though, and attach some information to what it is we're doing. By the way, now there's a change. The city's doing this. And it's,
Well.
If that's news.
Also, we can put that stuff on our website.
Yeah.
We can keep expanding our website just to have more information.
Often I hear when people don't even get involved, like, oh, I didn't know about it. Oh, nobody invited me. I didn't know that it was open to me. So I would just want to make sure that however, whatever we decide, whatever we communicate, just make sure strategically we're accessing as many people as we can through different modes, not just doing email.
If it goes in the Gazette, it's amazing how many people see it.
Exactly.
Yeah. I could.
I mean, you're as the chairperson, you're the spokesperson.
I'd have to check with that. I don't know. I this is a new area for me. I'm so used to being like just a radical citizen, and now I'm not.
What was your suggestion?
So.
I think you could write letters to the editor as the chairperson of a committee.
I would not recommend our first foray into the media as a go around, but.
Yeah.
I can also ghostwrite a letter and have a neighbor publish it. I've done that a million times.
Well, I mean, is that a hard thing? Hey, this new thing, we're going to know a bunch of trees, it's exciting, we hope people get involved, because the city cares about this, and we want to do something about climate change, and all these things that are hot button topics,
because
this is a good intersection, and we can do something about it.
Okay.
Ooh, what about tying something in with the climate adaptation thing happening in September 21st?
You said it's September 28th, yeah. Yeah, I'm sure they would love it if I put a plug in for that.
What is that?
That's like climate preparedness. They're having
Right. They've invited us to bring people to.
Okay, so let's just try to create some structure around all of these ideas. I don't know that we voted to have a charrette, so I don't know if we need to vote to postpone it. Did we actually vote to have a charrette in the fall? Okay, all right. So does anyone object?
We wanted it in the summer first.
Okay, all right. Does anyone object to us postponing the public charrette until after the tree inventory is
Well, I think I would move to integrated.
Yeah, okay, all right.
To make a vision a component of the overall inventory itself, with the iterative planning process as the foundation for the vision.
Right.
And now we are doing both at the same time.
Okay, all right. Does everyone agree with that? Any objections?
No.
Okay, then I think that's what we're going to be doing. And then since also on this topic is the survey, I'd like for us to go ahead and approve this survey or make final amendments to it and go ahead and approve it and then think about the timeline for this survey.
Were we thinking shortly after Labor Day or something back in the routine?
That works for me.
You had an idea towards the bottom there? Or,
yeah, adding language about the setback and
pronouns. Oh, right. Okay. So, think about how. All right. Well, what you could do is we could approve it pending my change language on this, and then I'll email everybody the change language. So, the setback.
You're essentially making people aware that they should write there somehow. Say that they want to set them.
Okay.
Is that right?
Yeah, yeah. Exactly.
And then I had an 11-hour email.
Yeah, I saw that.
Okay.
And I think that I covered
that. That was covered in easy.
Well, what I said was, so what you said is plant more trees?
Well, it's an option. Like.
And my option in number 6 was plant trees that are best suited for their site. Do you want me to just say plant more trees that are better suited for their site? It feels like it doesn't quite need to stand on its own.
It sounds like what you're saying is do a better job of citing the trees, which of course people are for, but I think support for more trees. So I guess I would say plant more well-suited, well-sighted trees.
Plant more well-sighted trees?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because
okay.
All right,
got it. Go ahead.
In 4 and 6, how do people the option to say they don't like trees? Because,
okay.
I've found some people have really strong tree opinions to make, you know, and they're...
Well, that could be part of plant more well-sighted trees or plant fewer.
Or cut more trees down.
Okay, cut more trees.
Right.
Well, I mean, wait.
option of at least.
Okay, so I got that in number four, and then what did you say in six as well?
Well, just some.
Six is tricky because we say, please rank how we should pursue, I mean, come on, it's our, this is our mandate.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, so it's one of those two, you know.
Okay, I think they will have expressed it in the I don't like trees, but bullet number four.
Yeah, it doesn't exactly, I don't like trees, but phrase it as, you know, you don't want to say.
Under other, I think if you give them the information, if you tell them they're going to cut down trees, then they're going to be calling my office and saying, I have a tree in front of my house.
Yeah, let's add it.
And I commented in your survey, I don't want the tree cut down.
All right, but you know what, I do see Andrew's point, in that, you know, you're just, if people get annoyed when they go, where's my, I don't like any of these options.
I'm doing like street to street, house to house, person to person outreach. Some people love trees, no problem, some people, man, don't care, and some people just hate them.
Yeah.
You know, and it really helps to give, because you want to know, like, okay, say for example, like geographically speaking, there's one street where like 9 out of 10 people hate trees, and you're just like wasting your time on trying to go to that street,
yeah.
You know? It's useful. I mean, obviously there's like millions of ways to sort of data, but I mean, generally the community is like really supportive or like instead of really negative. I think the community is going to be really supportive, but.
Will this survey come back in a way that we can divide up geographically?
I really wish, no, wait, definitely not geographic.
You could ask you to put it there.
Well, I put it as an optional thing. I personally think that you should always allow people to be anonymous if they,
yes.
they want to.
But I mean, people could say what, street or ward or?
Well, I do set optional name, email, and address.
Right, I know. But I'm just saying that Andrew's looking for in mine information that we're not going to have.
That's fine.
Yeah.
SurveyMonkey is pretty limited. Like you cannot, you know, it aggregates these things. So I wouldn't be able to then go, okay, all the under 18 people chose beauty as their number one choice for how they value trees. And all the age 80 and over said, I don't value public trees. I don't think that you can analyze the data to that level, unfortunately.
You can see by respondent though.
You can see it by per, but you have to do it manually.
Yeah, right.
It doesn't generate. So anyway, okay. So I've got the I don't value public shade trees. Does that feel good? And then I've got the plant more well-sighted trees. And I got your comment about you put in prints when I said overall beauty. You said aesthetic value. I just worried that some people might not know that word. So I just changed it to beauty instead of overall beauty. That work for people? Does anyone agree with me on that, or do you think
which question?
Beauty is
please rank how you value. I had written overall beauty, and Todd wrote in parentheses aesthetic value, but I just worry that sounds a little high for me.
Number four, two.
All right. Well, I'm just going to keep it at beauty, if you don't mind. Okay. All right. So we need a motion to accept this. I do think that we should vote on this because it's going to be kind of big document that's going to represent us.
All right, so there's three changes. There's Andrew's on number four, there's Rob's on number six, and then you're switching.
Yeah, so pending, so maybe the motion will be pending the approved language by email. Oh, you can't do that by email.
I'm comfortable approving
it. You can mail it, but you can't communicate about it.
Yeah.
I'm comfortable approving it with provision that you make those three changes.
Okay, all right, you trust me.
Right, and then you can send us
the revised. I'll send you revised, so you're basically entrusting me to come up with this.
Good.
So we have a motion, we have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Objections? Okay.
Thanks.
All right, onward we move. And now we're at 5:25. So, the November 1st grant application. So, I have, Andrew, you're shepherding that. Do you need support from anyone on the commission?
Yes, well, I mean, like, I guess I need to talk to Rich to see what you can do. Because, I mean, well, I guess what I can do is like draft up the letter, you know, the intent to apply, and then share it with you guys so you can comment on it. Because what they do is you do your intent to apply, they either approve or disapprove it, and then you do the full proposal after that. And so what? Here's what I owe you prior to September 1st. I need to talk to Rich, see what your vision is, see what think the, does the mayor have to apply, or do you, I think the mayor?
I think he does.
I don't know, we have to look at the, we can apply, and I can probably sign it, but you'll have to approve it.
What I might also do is send everybody the link to the grant application, and maybe, you know, because the, I remember this before, is the application itself is, there's a lot of detail that it requests. So just, you know, for example, it's a matching grant. So if we don't want to commit all of our money as a match, you can commit it in in-kind ways, volunteer support, time that we spend on it, things like that. So, you know, it might help if everyone just looks at it and has this, and then comes into your draft with a little bit more information.
The in-kind would be in-kind in support of the survey, not other.
Not necessarily, like for example, the shred.
Like Rich's time, our time, like say for example, we show up and we're helping to lead the components, you know, we just kind of count our time based upon the federal rate for what your time is worth. And then with Rich's time, you know, it's the salary and hours. So you can do a lot of in-kind work really quickly if people are working, you know, within the city. So it's in addition to the work in the survey. The trick is you don't want to count anything that you've already done. Like if we've done like, I don't know, 50 hours of work, you know, thinking about it.
Right.
It has to be in the grant period. So that's just the only thing.
Are there any survey companies that would allow people to work with them to actually volunteer on the ground to go out and be of use?
In terms of like firms and this sort of work?
Yeah, I mean, we're thinking of hiring a firm. There are presumably people in this room or in the community that are as qualified as probably some of the people that will be hiring at that. That's true.
The ones I've worked with, they usually train their people in a certain way. They have a format in their own software system that they use.
I see.
And also, Rob, I think that we came to the decision that we wanted this to be professionally conducted, and we want to kind of save our reserves for other things.
Okay.
Like, I just don't want to wear anyone out. On getting out on the street doing inventories when we could be spending our time doing other things. So, okay.
So that's my proposal. I will provide you a letter. Do you want the next meeting or the following?
Well, the next meeting is next week.
Okay.
So,
following?
It's up to you. The following is August 5th.
Let's do the first one on August 5th.
Okay. So that's going to be by August 5th. Great. I think that's it for that for now. The other thing, Andrew, is you just might want to reach out to Molly and just say, hey, is there anything you can send my way that might be helpful? Molly Freilicher, she's going to be the one that's going to be reviewing the grant. Okay, December 1st, so to December 1st, 157 trees planted. We've already talked about this quite a bit.
Kind of a question. Before December 1st, is that sort of the goal?
When will be
a good time to start? September 1st? Too early?
Depends on the weather.
Right.
October, November, I think. No, the last couple of winters we've had.
I think you can start mid-September.
Because if they're in grow bag, then the upset's a little less. Or if they're in containers, maybe September. It'll.
And even planting as long as you don't water, you know, that's the thing. If you have a homeowner that's going to sit in the water, it's possible. You know, it's better to plant.
The grow bags are going to have to spring.
Well, that's an idea that's come up, but I don't believe that the arrangement's been made with Amherst to allow that, except for the scarlet maples. So
we will have some grow bags?
Well, it depends. I mean, we have to.
Okay. Well, certain trees we have to plant this fall.
Right.
So I guess we've got to figure out exactly what that is.
Yes.
Maybe what we should do is we should meet outside of here, communicate with them about that, and at the same time we'll figure out when we're going to go tag the trees this month.
Okay. So have a meeting with
the three of us.
Three of us.
Probably, if that's all right.
Right. What, you know, if we.
Yep.
I can help with Bigelow.
He's offering to Bigelow, so we'll make a plan and we'll communicate with Andrew about Bigelow.
But if you're going anyway, I was just thinking if you didn't want to make that trip.
No. I was offering to go, but I tag along with professionals in order to, you know. Unless you want to send me on my own, which is okay, yeah, but I.
Quick question of the 151 trees, how many species?
Trying to be as diverse as we could.
So right now there's a problem in that there's a shortage of the kind of stock that we want to plant. So when we went out there, most places had little stock. You know, we were scooping up the last little bits of what we could get. And it's going to apparently be competitive for the next 5 years because there's just not enough trees coming along.
Huh, why is that?
It might have been the economic, there was such a poor economic time there for a while that people stopped planting because people stopped ordering their trees. And also, there's clearly, at least the places we're going to see, an uptick in the amount of planting that towns are doing, scooping it up. So, like Sunderland, Greenfield down to Sunderland, a whole bunch of trees. Amherst nursery is being, Amherst, the town of Amherst is taking it.
So does that mean next year we should order sooner?
We definitely should order sooner, and absolutely. And
something we should really look into is we can somehow work with someone and get a nursery of our own. We can get a lot more variety that way.
I think that would be a really good thing to do.
It really increase the variety of species.
The potential of stock is exactly what we want. I mean, when we go out there, we found that sometimes it's, oh, they have a 2.5-inch tree with a great big heavy ball and it costs $250.
You know, great, yeah, I mean, great city old man down by the, you know, in the floodplain, the river area, lease the whole thing to a nursery and say, you know, we take half the stock, you know, whatever. You set it up so they get to keep stuff and they get to grab stuff every year.
Just finished doing this nursery where we're working away with him. We came in about $45,000 for the overall cost for doing it on municipal land. Which, you know, it's like, it sounds like a lot of money, but at the same time, you know, when you're getting two blooms and you're taking the infrastructure investments with fencing and irrigation, you know, on 2/3 of an acre of a piece of land, you can do 400 to 600 trees. 5 years from now, you know, if you have volunteers or engaged to keep them alive, you can have completed a selection of trees that are sitting on. And it's, you know, I mean, it's not that expensive, you know, it's just kind of.
What stage is this now, Holden?
We bought everything, we're going to get it done by August, so.
Maybe you could invite some of us to come see.
Come on down.
Vision.
We're doing the grow bag system.
You'll use grow bag, yeah.
We don't want to have equipment limitations. That's like our main goal is not to have equipment limitations.
Yeah, all right.
Yes.
Well, anyone
yes.
who wants to come on down, check in with Andrew.
Yeah, I'd love to see it.
Yeah, I would too.
All right.
Well, and I'm just wondering if so should I kind of keep that boiling on the agenda on our, you know, wish list is to get a nursery of our own. So the first thing that we need is land that's close enough to folks who can do watering, right?
Water.
Should we inquire with Wayne or the CONSCOM whether or not conservation land can be used for that purpose?
Well, the vocational school used to do this for the town. So the land is still there that they used.
The land is still there, it's full of trees.
Oh, it's full of trees.
Volunteers?
No, trees we planted. Trees I bought.
Oh, really?
Yep.
So is the land still, I mean, could we convert it tomorrow back into a nursery if we had the resources?
We have to pull all the stock out of there and do something with it all.
Is it all overgrown?
Yeah. Oh. It used to be, when they used to have the CEDA program at Smithville, when they had the CEDA program in general for the school system, when they had young kids, the CEDA kids would actually, John Sofranski used to work at Smith Vocational School. He was the forestry fell by the wayside.
So nothing exists like it anymore?
No.
Is it worth?
Miracle.
What's that?
My concept was more, if it's possible, give the nursery the land. And come up with an agreement where, you know, you plant, this is what you're gonna grow on this property, and every year the city will take whatever it is, but it's your land to grow stock as you wish, you get to keep whatever percentage of it, and the city takes the other. It's basically trees in lieu of rent.
You see that down there?
No, I just came up.
It's an interesting concept, because they're talking about taking our nursery away at Smith.
Yeah, you know, up Fort Hill.
That actually happened, and maybe we can partner up.
All right.
I'll look into it from my end.
Okay.
I think that's a good concept.
So you're saying, Jay, that you'll contact someone in the city about this?
I'll see how things are going on our end, as far as whether we're still gonna have a nursery or not.
All right, we'll keep circling back to that one. Anything else about the planting in December? One question I just had was, you know, I could tie this into the press release if I knew the absolute earliest time that you might start planting. I could say, if you're interested in helping out with, you know, planting in mid-September through December, please contact, and I can give you as a contact person.
I did run this by a little bit. I spoke to Jay on the issue of training and doing this. I actually think it's great that a lot of people would participate, but at the same time, if we're actually trying to put trees in, we probably want like three little groups of four each planting the trees that are pretty well trained. So I don't know that we're actually looking right now until we get this sort of core of people that know how to plant and are out planting going.
But that could also be a learning opportunity for anybody who wants to show up. So this is how you plant the tree.
It is.
I'm wondering if we can get Rick Harper, who is, you know, UMass Extension Service forester, who is one of the best teachers of how to plant a tree.
Yeah.
To come for one of them.
We have
for a little training and teach folks how to plant a tree, and then they're ready to go for.
Yeah, I mean, we have several people who, I mean, did Rick Harper, but also there are, you know, Jay, I might volunteer to do it, and others. I just think that.
I think we have a big training weekend with two or three people showing how to do it.
Okay.
And then divide up into weekends, right, groups for planting.
Well, so why don't you guys work on this concept?
Right, there's a concept, and I think the concept for quality control is to not have more than a dozen or maybe two dozen, a certain limit, so that people aren't coming in and out from the group, that they actually form a group and plan.
Well, how about you guys come up with a concept and some dates, and when you know, that'll be part of my press release.
Okay, when's the press release?
I don't know yet. Probably early September.
Oh, we'll have it well before then. We'll trade.
Yeah. Okay. Other business. I do have a couple of thoughts that I want to give other people the time.
One thing is, I had Councilor Adams emailed me about the draft ordinance and asked me your time frame, so I have been in communication with him. Just told him we're meeting this evening, and that out of this meeting would come a timetable as to when we can get the information back. So
it looks like we're planning on August 20th.
Yeah.
Well, before, exactly.
Sometime between the 5th and the 20th.
Okay, so I can email him, and I'll CC you so you have that information.
Scott and I will have a draft by August 5th.
All right, well, one thing I want to ask is, who you feel is the highest priority for me to invite to the next commission meeting?
Can you talk to Parks and Rec already?
We have not talked to Parks and Rec. You mean just about, like, park trees? Yeah, I mean,
park trees are all maintained by me.
They're more programmed than, right?
Yeah, they're Parks and Recreation Department, it's all about programming. Although they do own, like, for example, Florence Fields, they physically hold the deed to it, but all the maintenance practices are done by the Department of Public Works.
So if, like, Agnes Fox is doing a tree, say you can tree Agnes Fox?
Yeah, yeah.
How's that all?
Okay. Anyone from your department, your tree crew?
Probably the tree crew at some point.
Okay.
Maybe in September.
So we've got, just to remind you, storm, Doug McDonald with Stormwater, gosh, it's completely blanking out.
Public Utility.
Yes, Lance.
Lance Wade.
Wade from just that might be an important one to prioritize. Who are some of the others we mentioned? Terry Masterson, Economic Development, and the Forester.
Michael Morey.
Yeah.
Are there any nonprofits in town that touch on this area?
No. Now, the closest one would be Grow Food Northampton, because we have potential land where a nursery could grow. We, I mean, they. But no, the only other one I can think of is Green Northampton, which is really just a one-man show. It's David Stark, and it's a nonprofit with a very broad mission statement that could conceivably, because I explored this with him before I joined the commission, it's a 501c3. So because the mission is so broad about sustainability and greening, it could conceivably have as part of its projects something related to trees, and therefore it could accept charitable dollars related to trees, which is really a nice thing in terms of if we ever want a separate revenue stream for tree-related donations, it could potentially. But I'm not really ready to go that way, because it's not a really, other than in name, it's not really a nonprofit with a board of directors and appropriate oversight and stuff like that. It could become that.
Yeah, I was just thinking, anybody like down on Main Street or Cleveland Street where all that reconstruction is proposed?
So we could invite Suzanne Beck, who's, right, is she the director still, Chamber of Commerce?
It's something that's left of the bid, or some residue or new organization?
The downtown is going through a process with, it's called the DNA, the Downtown Northampton Association. It was an advisory committee kind of put together by the mayor. I sit on that, as does Suzanne. In the process of coming up with, like, what is the new organization process by which the downtown is supported and enhanced. Suzanne is definitely part of that, getting a little more involved.
All right, so I just need some directives about who to invite to our next commission meeting.
For next week?
Yeah. Well, I don't think I'll get one by next week.
I think my suggestion would be to have Lance Wade come to the first meeting in August. Although that's going to be on the 5th.
Yeah.
I will not be present for that meeting.
Do you want to be? Should we postpone?
We'll confirm it better.
So second meeting in August. How about the stormwater guy? I'm personally interested in the extent to which they see trees as part of the stormwater management solution.
That's from money, me, you know, everything I understand.
Yeah.
The discussion is geared more towards looking at ways to integrate stormwater infrastructure with urban portion. Theory is making its way up to the policy level, and so right now the debate is whether or not town can infrastructure rather than the hard infrastructure.
Right.
So depending on how that shakes out, it might be a lot more money.
Okay. Does anyone object to me inviting them to our next meeting? Okay.
For next week?
Well, I'll contact him immediately. If by chance he can come next week, great. If not, I'll.
Understood.
So
if not, maybe Lance could come next week.
Which could. But Rich won't be here.
No,
you're here this week. I'll be here the first Wednesday.
Okay, I'll reach out to both of them and see what works. Just some other, so this is definitely other businessy stuff. This isn't high priority, but I just wanted to throw these out there. One is that, you know, I really asked explicitly of Alan Snow, the tree warden in Amherst, and he said that their policy of assessing $95 per inch for tree removal, for illegal tree removal or unauthorized tree removal, or even authorized tree removal, is a policy and it's not an ordinance. Which means that we could do the same thing. We could create a policy here that's effective immediately. And, you know, and Rich could start collecting revenue that could immediately go to a tree planting fund.
But there are very few removals, is that not true?
There's going to be one on a Dare Place. There's going to be a tree, public shade tree hearing on Hinkley Street, construction of Hinkley. And then there's going to be the public shade tree hearing, which is already been covered. Elm Street by Smith's College's mitigation of planting and the labor to plant the trees and the care and aftercare. So the only significant funding is going to come from the Dare Place. And we don't have a policy presently on the books. Mayor and I had a conversation when we met at the Dare Place about having a policy that he approves that allows us to charge $90 or $95 per caliber inch of tree. I'm not so sure how the homeowners are going to react to it, but it is what it is. So
you're working on that?
Yes.
Okay, yep. Great. I wonder if we need to, you know, take an official vote of approval of that sort of policy.
I think maybe what I should do is draft the policy, and I could actually send it to you to review.
Okay.
And then if you approve it, you can
vote
upon it, and then go forward to the mayor's office.
I think Alan Snow said that even though they have that policy, there's a lot of negotiating.
Well, in the enforcement is his favorite part of the job.
Enforcement, there's a lot of negotiation.
Yeah.
In my opinion, there is. It is what it is. It's either you pay to have the tree removed, or you don't pay the fee, the tree stays.
Right.
You know, and I was thinking about what you said earlier about the nine people on the street that don't want the trees on there. You don't give them a choice.
Right.
Because if that was the case, then this whole city would be devoid of trees.
So, yeah, so it's 95 at
It used to be 90, it's now 95 in Amherst. I like the round number 100 personally, but
But does that even get close to the value of the tree as established in the
inventory?
Is it this?
That's a great question. Probably not.
Probably $400. Place a 2-inch tree anyway.
Right.
Right.
4 to 5 months.
So it should be double that.
Yeah.
But again, real world.
Yeah.
You know, what's reasonable and what we could actually get from
it. It's a lot more reasonable than state laws now.
Yeah.
Right, which is only after the fact after it's been removed.
All right, Rich, when do you think you can get us a draft policy to remove?
Possibly by the next.
Like next week?
Possibly.
Okay.
I want to say possibly. Not the end of fiscal year.
Okay, so let's say by August then.
Okay.
And Lily, just for clarification, so by making it a policy versus an ordinance, there's more.
It just means that it doesn't need to go through all of the ordinance process.
Yeah. But does it have more teeth to it?
Is it probably less?